Hi, I'm Lydia with Raindrop Lila, and today I'm part of a collaboration hosted by Justine and Mandy. They're celebrating their 1 year anniversary as a Facebook group, and basically they're holding a collaboration and asking a bunch of different makers to join in and kind of talk about their background in junk journaling, how they got started, and maybe share a few tips. So I'm getting on here, and this is my first time being actually on camera, and so that's a little bit different for me, but I wanted to share kind of a few things about how I kind of got started with junk journaling. I used to actually be a scrapbooker. That's probably the first thing I did, although I was always pretty creative as a child, but I didn't really do that much like scrapbooking until I got older. Maybe I was like 15 years old when I created my first scrapbook, and I just created it because I wanted to kind of have a place to keep my photos and my memories. It's kind of my start, so I did a lot of scrapbooking. And then I did a little bit of creative art journaling. Before junk journaling was even a thing, I kind of started experimenting with art journals. And I always loved to collect vintage pieces and like postcards. I always really loved anything that was old. And I also have a background in photography, so I collected a lot of vintage like props and things like that. So even though there's been periods in my life where I had to take like kind of a bigger break, like when I was pregnant, I couldn't do anything creative. I just didn't have the energy for that. When my kids were little, I packed everything away and I kind of put all my crafting things in boxes and put them away, and I knew I had to take a break. But during that time, I still found different ways to be creative. Like I was creative in planning my kids' birthday parties. I was able to make a lot of crafty things for their parties. Also with invitations, I did some graphic design. When my kids were little, I was able to wear them as babies, like in like the little carrier, and I was able to still do photography that way. And I also learned to do, I learned to use Photoshop back then to edit my pictures. And then, so little by little, I would spend time creating, and by the time junk journaling kind of became a thing, I heard about it and I thought, wow, this is so cool. It kind of combines everything I love. I love vintage, I love photography, I love all the old papers and books. So being able to kind of combine all that was really cool for me, because I started junk journaling. I thought, wow, you can use anything. And for me, that made a big difference. I love having the freedom to just use anything and not be limited, I guess. I love to use all kinds of different mediums in my creative process. I love the idea of using laces and all the fabrics, and even add stitching to it. I've always been a creative person, so no matter what, I think I've always found ways to have some kind of creative outlet, whether I had to put all my crafting things aside and just kind of create online. I did a lot of digital scrapbooking. I did a lot of photography. I got into even photography, like photo editing, where I did like photo manipulation. So I would take like 10 different photos and put them together, so that I was able to do while my kids were little, and I could hold them and like rock them to sleep, but then have my laptop out and still kind of like learn the editing process, and I could spend, you know, days on just one photo. So that was really fun for me. So I think that's what I'm trying to say, is that even if you have to take a break from crafting, or you feel like you can't really get straight into it, I think that as a creative person, you will always have a way of having like some kind of a creative outlet, no matter how busy you are. A lot of times, you know, even just doodling or writing can be a creative outlet, and you don't even need a lot of tools, I suppose, for, you know, just drawing. And even for junk journaling, is you don't need a lot of tools for that. That's one thing that that I think that is important as a beginner is that you don't have to go out and buy all the things. You can just start with what you have, and I will actually show you some of my first journals that I did. And you don't have to go and buy all the tools, because you can usually find ways to use or to do those same things without the tools, right? So I think that's important to realize that you can always buy more products and you can always like add more to your stash, but you don't have to. You don't have to feel limited just because you don't have all the tools that other creatives use. I mean, even if you don't have a color printer, let's say. I didn't have one for a while, and I just printed black and white, and I would either hand color them, and that's another way to just like have a creative outlet, is by finding ways to use what you have. So you can print on a black and white printer, and you can use colored pencils to fill them in. You can use even eyeshadow. I think that was really fun. I think I have a video on that, but anyways, you can even use eyeshadow chalks to fill them in, or you can just coffee dye them and have like that really pretty vintage look to your journals. I've used scrapbook paper. Scrapbook paper is super inexpensive. I actually would pick my favorite digitals and I would take them to Staples and have them printed. So for a few dollars, you can still do that too. And then you can, junk journaling isn't like, you can have like a variety of pages. You have book pages, coffee dyed pages. You can do avocado dyed papers. You can have, you can use different types of dyes and just dye your papers. And then you mix in either your scrapbook paper so you can have more visual impact, or you can mix in a printable if you wanted to, or even like wrapping paper. You can add some bits and pieces of like a design just to kind of fill in. So there's so many ways that you can do it without actually having, like, I hear that a lot. I don't have a printer, or I don't have, you know, all the tools, but you can actually do a lot of it without all the tools. So basically about 7 years ago, we moved cross country. We moved from Seattle to Texas. And so when we moved to Texas, our first place was a tiny little cabin. And it was super small, and so I didn't bring out all my crafty things. And that's when I first started junk journaling. So I had everything in storage, but then I would pick what I wanted to work on. Like I had my coffee dyed papers, and I kept everything in a box under my bed. And then when I was ready to work on them, I'd pull them out and bring them to the kitchen table, and I'd work there. And when I was done, I put everything back in the box and put them under my bed so that I kept everything kind of organized. So even if you don't have like a dedicated crafting space, you can still make it work, and you don't need like a lot of tools. Even back then, I thought, I can't bring out all my tools. I just don't have the space for it. So I just kept like kind of the basics. And I think the basics is like, I don't know, a paper cutter. You don't even need that, actually. You can just use a ruler and scissors. And here's the deal. When you make a journal, like, okay, so like I have this journal here. If you're gonna use pages, you just fold them in half and you got your page. You don't even need a paper cutter. You just can use scissors basically for cutting different bits and pieces out. So, even, I suppose you might want to if you buy scrapbook paper, but even then you can buy the 8.5 by 11 scrapbook paper. You just fold it in half and you have your pages for your journal. So basically, if you want to make a journal, like, you can keep it really simple and just do, you know, cardstock paper. You can go with embroidery thread. So I'm thinking paper, needle, scissors, some kind of thread or ribbon to bind your journal with. And so you can start it with very limited supplies. You don't need to have all the pieces, but of course it's really fun to just be able to splurge and buy the pieces. And I would suggest you just kind of focus on what tools you think are most important. I'm going to link down below all the ladies that are actually part of this collaboration, and if you watch them all, they will all talk about what tools they love and they think are really important for junk journaling, or like the brands they really love or really wanted to invest in. So but yeah, I would say just get started. I think that's the most important thing, because another thing is you don't know if you're gonna stick with it. You want to start, and you don't want to spend a lot of money before you realize, oh, this is really my thing, I really love doing this. So you're gonna want to just kind of like get your feet wet and get, you know, started and see how you like it and how you do, because maybe your thing is something else. Maybe you're creative, but maybe you don't want to spend $100 or $200 or whatever starting a new craft. But anyway, so let's see, tips. I guess for tips, I could show you guys like this little journal that I made. Is actually, it's one of my favorite journal because it's got a lot of my memories in it. The cover is actually scrapbook paper, and what I did was I first made the journal with just scrapbook paper, and then it's mostly coffee dyed paper, random bits and pieces of paper, and then when I created the layout is when I would add different pieces of paper like colors, and this is vellum. But let's see, one of my tips is this is a great way to store your memories. I think I really loved using it. Like, I could just add a photo of my daughter and kind of write a sentiment down or a memory I have in there. And so I guess for me it's like another way of combining writing. I love writing, and I also love photography, and I also love kind of like memory keeping. So doing a lot of this is kind of a combination of everything. And then I have like bits and pieces of lace. This was actually one of my daughters. This is my daughter here. And this piece of lace was one of her dresses that she outgrew. And a lot of clothes that my kids wear, sometimes they're stained and you can't like pass them on. So that was kind of perfect. I thought, wow, I can just, you know, cut them up and use them. And that way I actually remember, oh, this was her dress, or this was his shirt, or whatever. So, like this piece right here was actually a tunic that I had. And so I tore it into strips, and I love this. I love the way it tears. I love that fraying. You can see that. So that's kind of one of my tips, is use fabric from your own clothes. Like, go in your closet, look through your closet, and see what has... I mean, I guess it depends on your style. Like, if you like lace, you're going to want to use a lot of lace. If you like shabby chic, lacy, maybe Victorian, you're going to want, you know, that pretty Victorian lacy look. And I love that. But then I also love the fraying. So if you like that, you might want to look at, like, clothes that are, like, linen, even jean material. Like, they have jeans for children. It's like a softer jean material. And when you, you could snip it, and when you tear it, it has all the little fraying on it, or, you know, pants or shorts or whatever, or even shirts. So that's kind of nice to use, I think, as like I used it here. Let's see where else I used it. I like to layer things on top of fabric like that, or like right here is a piece, I don't know if you can see it. This picture is backed up, and you can see some of, just like right there. Okay, so you can use fabric from anything, but I think that it's just important to kind of figure out what kind of fabric you want to use and kind of match it with what your style is. Like, okay, so here's another one. This is kind of more like, it's a little bit grungy, but I actually made a ruffle out of it. And I attached this tiny little lace piece. And so I think it's really cute. So the idea of junk journaling is that you can use so many different things. And basically, you're not limited. You're only limited by your creativity. So you're going to want to be creative with what you like and try different styles out. I love to challenge myself. This is maybe another tip for you guys. Even though I might not have a certain style, I like to challenge myself and say, okay, well, let's see what I can do with these colors that I don't normally gravitate to. Maybe, like, I love vintage, I like pastel colors, but maybe I haven't used, I don't know, like bright colors, really bright colors. That's probably one of my things that I haven't done, and I actually kind of experimented with that this spring, and actually I did a little bit of that last year too. So basically I can show you like, okay, how would it be if I use just, you know, super bright colors? And so basically these are some of the pages with like really bright colors that kind of pop, like that green right there. I did this page. This is actually a photo, and so I just added some writing at the top. But I'm trying to see what else I have that is kind of out of the ordinary. A lot of times if you do that, like, it's good as a beginner to start and kind of figure out what your style is and try different things. Try things that you love, work with, you know, what you love, but then it's also good to kind of try different things out. Okay, so I'm not sure what happened. My phone just kind of turned off, but I was kind of trying to talk about trying different things. I think that's really great to stretch yourself as an artist, is to try different, you know, colors, patterns. It could be like a challenge. And so I try to kind of do that sometimes. I try to make that kind of a habit every now and then, to kind of like step out of my comfort zone and work with maybe different colors that I don't usually gravitate towards. And I think that's really good for your kind of creative process. And so even if, like, let's say, even if you don't love a certain style, working with those and trying to make it look good as a design is also, I think that's a really good way to grow as a creative person or as an artist, to create basically a beautiful, you know, either journal layout or design, even if it's not your style. So, like, a lot of times I'll see maybe like a home design, or like the interior home design, and I think, okay, that's not my style, but it's really beautifully done. The design elements are there. It's like pleasant, it's balanced, if that makes sense. So I think that that's really a good way to challenge yourself to grow as an artist. So that's kind of one of my tips that I love to kind of do. I do that a lot when I create digitals. I like to try different things and kind of push myself to work with different colors. So anyways, I don't know what else I can share. I think that one, that tip was really big for me also with creating scrapbooks. And when you work with people too, like, I used to make invitations, and I do like graphic design. That was really important, because somebody might ask you to create something, and you have to be able to kind of like create something that's beautiful, but maybe not in your style, in somebody else's style, if that makes sense. So that, I think that's kind of fun as a challenge. And I think that it's also great because it breaks you up from like your standard, and you can kind of take a break from those colors for a while. It's almost like a palette cleanser. Like, it gives you a break from your usual, and then when you go back, everything feels a little bit fresh too. I don't know if that makes sense, but that's how I feel, at least. So a lot of times I'll jump around between different styles and colors. I find that it really helps my creative process, especially if I'm like kind of have creative block, and I'm kind of burnt out and I'm not sure like what I want to do. Sometimes doing a small project like that, that's kind of really unexpected, kind of helps me. I'm going to try to keep it short, so I'm going to end it here, because I'm going to probably have to chop it up and edit it a little bit too. So I'm going to leave it there. I hope that this was helpful. I didn't plan that much. I just kind of shared what was on my mind. And so I hope you guys enjoyed it. And please go take a look at everybody else's videos. And it's really nice because you get to know the people in the community and see their work and kind of their background. It was really fun for me to hear a lot of the different makers because I've been following different people, and to hear their story was really nice too. Okay, thank you so much for joining me. I hope you guys have a lovely day. Bye-bye.